Okay, well, thank you everybody for joining us for our conversation, what I like to call our chat with champs. We are here with Senator McGuire of District 2, who represents the North Coast and North Bay. Senator McGuire has been a longtime state park champion. He also has the largest number of state parks in his district. So he not only is a great representative, he understands and truly lives a park's life. He's out there, he knows the parks, he knows the community, and he knows what the incredible benefits are of parks in serving the community needs. So thank you, Senator, for joining us today. It's really great to see your face again, and there's a lot happening in your district. So tell us what's going on. What's going on with your constituents? What are you hearing? Understanding in terms of these challenging times, whether it's dealing with this pandemic and distant learning and all that's happening right now?
Yeah, Holly, thank you so much. I'm really grateful to be with you and so excited to be talking about parks. And especially during this pandemic, I got to say, and I think you would agree with me, parks are more important than ever. What we see on the North Coast is a lot of struggle. Folks are struggling to be able to stay healthy, and they're struggling economically based off of the economic fallout from the coronavirus. We have just about 6.5 million Californians, a record number on unemployment. And that is why it is so important that we keep a thriving public park and state park system in this state. And you said it, between the Golden Gate Bridge and the Oregon border, there are more state parks than anywhere else in the state of California. And not only do those parks protect some of our most cherished natural resources and open spaces, but they also are significant economic drivers for some of the most rural communities in the state of California. And what we know right now is the state of California has a $95 billion outdoor recreational economy. It's one of our largest economic sectors in the entire Golden State. And it's an economic driver on the North Coast. We have some of the highest levels of poverty in the state per capita, in right outside of the doors of the Redwood State and National Park. And without that park and without the visitors, well over 1 million every year, communities wouldn't be able to make it. And I think it's really critical that we stop talking just about parks' natural beauty and or recreational benefits, but parks also have a significant economic benefit. They're economic drivers for the state of California, and they also have health benefits as well to the people of California.
Yeah, we certainly agree. Earlier on in this year, we hosted a conversation with Carolyn Beteta of Cal Tourism to talk specifically about this. And understanding that, you know, tourism is a huge driver of our economy, and state parks are sort of the jewel in which drives people to them. So, you know, during this time when we see that the pandemic and the economy and all the stressors of our life right now are driving people outdoors, how do we kind of capitalize on this opportunity to really, we don't need to talk about how parks are relevant anymore. People know that, they feel it, they're living it. But how do we talk about parks being a critical part of the future of California thriving from an economic standpoint, from a standpoint of when our parks are healthy and thriving, so is California's economy? Any thoughts there?
100%. And I don't want to get too political with you, Holly, but I just want to say, I think one of my biggest frustrations is that whenever there is a downturn in the economy, one of the first on the chopping block are state parks, and it's unacceptable. When we take a look at the benefits that state parks brings to this state and to the residents, the almost 40 million folks, it's significant. So when we take a look also at this pandemic, parks are more important than ever. I want to talk a little bit about that, if that's all right. When folks have literally nowhere else to go, and they are trying to be able to beat the record heat that we're seeing, they need to be able to escape to the outdoors, especially low-income communities. And state parks provides that opportunity for so many in California. But here's my frustration. Number one, I think we need to make state parks much more diverse. We need to lower the cost of our annual pass. We need, for every kid that gets a library card, I believe they should also get an annual pass to the state parks. We need more kids of color in our state parks. We need to outreach to urban communities much more to make state parks relevant. Because what we all know is that they have intrinsic value, both for their beauty, for the natural resources, and economically. But it is up to all of us to be able to make state parks much more accessible. And that is my goal. And I think the other piece is we need to now also start building out a spine to state parks. And what I mean by that is, in a project that we're working on the North Coast, is developing the Great Redwood Trail. The Great Redwood Trail would redevelop a nearly 300-mile dilapidated railway that runs from the San Francisco Bay in the south all the way up to Humboldt Bay in the north. And an individual would be able to walk that trail. It would be the longest contiguous rail trail in America, and pass through national parks and national recreation areas, walk through the stunning Eel River Canyon, one of the most desolate areas in the nation. It is spectacular beauty. And it will then connect state parks, national recreation areas, coastal areas, our rivers. And that's where I think we also need to start thinking is, how do we build out that spine, that network, so that you can hike and bike and potentially ride your horse into multiple state park and or national recreational areas, national parks, all in a week's time.
Yeah, I love that idea. And I think so much of our community would love to be behind that type of effort to support that connectivity between communities and parks, and thinking about the accessibility of parks. You know, access and equitable access to parks has been a huge, you know, pillar of priority for us, you know, advocating so much. To your point, when the budget turned, so did parks, right? It was astronomically cut. We fought really hard. By your side, I know you were a huge champion in the, you know, Senate budget, you know, hearings to really support parks. And we were glad to see a lot of it reinforced, specifically the $20 million for the outdoor equity grants, right? And, you know, so I think we're thinking about, okay, well, how do we create sustainable solutions for park access, especially during these hard times, which is why I really love the idea of the library card. You could check out your pass. The other idea to bring to your attention is, you know, we're thinking about anybody who has the Golden State Advantage CalFresh card should get free admittance, right? These are families who wouldn't go anyways because they wouldn't afford the entry fee to it. You know, we're looking at solutions like, how do we accept the National Park Every Kid Outdoor Pass at state parks? And I think these are all just creative solutions to kind of meet this moment, right? And I think we are excited, really excited by your creative solutions to meet this moment, because in this moment of challenge, we have to be creative to meet the needs of our community. And we have to come together to think about out of the box about what can we do with our land, our public spaces, to bring the community together in a safe way to heal and to move forward. So, you know, I'd like to, you know, change it a little bit and now ask you a little bit about, you know, the health. You had mentioned that a lot of the folks in your district are suffering from health issues. We're seeing that you have a lot of fires, wildfires happening in your district right now. And that's compounding the health issue with air quality, the heat. What are you seeing parks playing a role, or what are the creative solutions that you see in mind to help address the health needs of your constituents and of Californians when it comes to our state parks?
Holly, I just want to say amen to what you just said in regards to whether it's the CalFresh card or library card, that kids up to the age of 18 have automatic entry into a state park is a no-brainer, right? And I think it helps long-term because it makes parks more relevant. It makes parks more relevant into the lives of some who may not otherwise have the opportunity, because that entry fee is too much of a barrier to be able to access our state recreational system, which is simply unacceptable. And by the way, our state park system will be much more successful when it's relevant to folks in big communities and small up and down this state. In the state park system should be the most popular department out of all of them in the state, because it provides amazing value. So let's talk about health benefits. So I live in Sonoma County. And working with our Department of Public Health when I was on the Board of Supervisors, working with our regional park system, we started providing regional park passes to individuals who may be on Medi-Cal and unable to access our regional parks. They got an annual pass They can go to any of our nearly 40 regional parks, whether it's out on the coast or on the Russian River or inland up in the Golden Hills surrounding Santa Rosa. And it just made sense. It gets folks out there to exercise. It is an amazing mental health booster, right? You're able to think, you're able to clear your head, you're able to be with a loved one, and you come out refreshed. Our state park system is one of the best tools when it comes to mental health that we have available, right? And I think that's where we really need to start thinking in this state. State parks should not be just a standalone department. It should be a department that has partnerships with our library system to provide every kid access through their library card. It should be for those who may not otherwise be able to afford it and flash the CalFresh debit card. And we should be working with the California Department of Public Health to be able to get folks out into our state parks during this time of COVID. You could socially distance, right? Socially distance while still getting out there, enjoying the fresh air, the amazing beauty that state parks has to offer. And I think that California can be a leader on this. I think the world of Jerry Brown. I think he's one of the best governors that this state has ever had. But where I felt frustrated, just being candid, during his time as governor, is that the state park system saw significant budget cuts. So we have to rebuild this system. We have to be able to reimagine what state parks will be here in this century. And it should be based off of diversity. It should be based off of inclusion. And it should be based off of access. Access and equality for all. And state parks will never be a moneymaker for the state institution. But we got to take a look at what it does for the public's health and what it does for our economy. I want to get back to where we started. Our outdoor recreational economy, hiking, biking, camping, $95 billion economy. $95 billion, one of the largest and fastest growing economic sectors that this damn state has. So when we invest in a strong and vibrant state park system, we're investing in a strong and vibrant California economy. And as you know, Holly, we need that more than ever as we come out of this COVID-induced recession.
Yeah, back at you. Amen. And on that note, I feel like that is the best way to end this conversation, because it is all the things that I hope that we can do with you. You know, I'm excited that you have so much creativity and energy to reimagine the possibilities of the state park system. We share that passion, we share that vision with you. And the only thing we ask is to figure out ways we can work together to do this together. Because I believe when we come together and we have these creative solutions and we have political will to do it, and the community is demanding it, that we can make it happen. So thank you again, Senator, for joining us. I know you have a very busy schedule. So thank you for all that you're doing for our state, and we will get this work done together.
Holly, love being with you. And Holly's being very modest. She has really been a leader on this issue, and she's doing it homeschooling her kids right now because they're not able to be in school. We were just talking prior to the broadcast today about how crazy life is. And Holly, I just want to say thank you and your entire team, because during this time of a public health crisis, regardless of what you have going on at home, you continue to move the mission forward. And we owe you a debt of gratitude, even with all the screaming kids. So I just want to say thank you, Holly, because we are living in crazy times. Am I right?
Yes, absolutely. 100%. Well, thank you. And until we see each other again, take care.